What are event-driven architectures, and how can they enable real-time user interactions, pluggable microservices, and extensible streaming and data analytics? My name's Whitney. I'm on the cloud team here at IBM. Before I dig in on event-driven architectures specifically, I'd like to talk about system design more generally, and specifically the Reactive Manifesto. The Reactive Manifesto is a set of community-driven guidelines that are intended to give a cohesive approach to systems design. So at the core of the Reactive Manifesto, we want our system to be message-driven. And so specifically, asynchronous messaging. And then also we want our system design to be scalable. And we want it to be resilient. So this implies distributed systems or Kubernetes. So by scalable, we mean that we want the hardware use to expand as the workload expands and contract as the workload contracts. And by resilient, we mean we don't want any single point of failure. And if the system does fail, we want it to be able to tolerate that elegantly. So with this foundation in place, we should be able to build a system that is responsive. Responsive is the value. On top of that, we can expect a system that is maintainable. So it means it's easy to change, easy to fix a bug or do an update. And we want one that is extensible. So we should be able to expand the system easily. So now that we have the core of what we want our systems designed to look like, now let's level set here and talk about like what is an event. So an event is a statement of fact, an immutable statement of fact about something that happened in the past. So let's give that some context. We'll talk about a retail application. So our retail application has a checkout service. And that checkout service is going to want to communicate with an inventory service, a shipping service, and a contact service. So with the messaging model, if the inventory wants to know what the checkout is doing, the checkout will send a message directly to inventory to let the inventory know a checkout happened, and another one directly to shipping and directly to contact. So with messaging, we have targeted delivery. Not only that, but inventory can maybe send a message back to checkout. It can be a conversational delivery, conversational messaging. And then finally, let's talk about where that message lives. Before it's sent, it's lives on the host service or on the producing service. When it's received, it lives on the host service until it's received by the consuming service. Or in the case of a message broker, it might sit on a machine in between. But regardless, the data persistence is transient. Now let's compare that to eventing. So if our checkout service is producing events, it's producing an event every time a checkout happens without any concern to which service is consuming that. And so with that, we have a system that's highly scalable. So we have three services here interested in the checkout, but even if we expand it to 100 services listening to checkout, that wouldn't affect what the checkout service is doing in any way. Not only that, when we have all the checkouts in a row, we come up with an event log, and it can be replayable. So we have a stream history, and a history of everything that every checkout event that has happened. And then our data persistence, depending on how the cluster is set up, it can be set up to be immutable. It can be there forever. as long as you have the physical hardware to back it up. So we have, instead of having transient data persistent, so we have permanent or possibly permanent. Not immutable, but permanent. Data persistence. ENT. So this is the foundation of our event-driven architecture. So we have a resilient, a reactive, responsive system design, and then that message-driven element is event messaging specifically. So when we go into our proper event design, the first thing we're going to consider are our event producers. So we might have a web application that produces events, and we might have a mobile application. And let's say we also have an edge device that's producing events, so Internet of Things device. And all of these are producing events into our system. So this piece of the system here that has all the events running through it, this is called the event backbone. So what does this system enable? Well, first of all, we have our event logs being produced by all of the producing applications. So the event logs can do a few things. First, it can trigger an action. So if we have an Internet of Things device, let's say our Internet of Things device is a robot vacuum cleaner. And when we turn on that robot vacuum cleaner, it spins up a pod on the infrastructure. And that pod is a function as a service. So a function as a service is a modular piece of code often associated with an edge device that doesn't exist on a server on the server until it is turned on, and that's when it is spun up. So that's called serverless. A function as a service sits on top of serverless infrastructure. But the point is that event triggers an action of the with the robot vacuum cleaner to spin up, bounce all around the house, make everything squeaky clean. And then when the function is finished running, it powers down. And perhaps that'll cause our function as a service to send another event back into the system to let it know that the function is complete. Another cool thing about the event log is it can be used to help optimize and customize data persistence. So if our web application is maybe it's our retail application that we talked about before, and it's doing a stream of checkout events. Well, our inventory service can be reading from that, and it's keeping track of a local data store that's keeping track of the inventory. So our inventory service will consume from that data stream from the web application. It'll modify the local data, and then it'll produce again into the event backbone. And so this new stream is giving the most current inventory to any other application in the system that wants to consume from it. And so while we're talking about data, another thing that happens, we can save all of the data that comes through the system. So all the raw data or all of the transformed data here at the end, once it goes through the system, we'll save it all in a huge data lake. And this is what's gonna power really data-heavy applications like AI, for example. And the data lake is accessible from anywhere in the system that any service that you let consume from it. So another thing that our event-driven architectures can enable are stream processing. So this is built on top of the Apache Kafka Streams API. So let's say that our mobile app is producing, let's say it's a music streaming service. And every time, let's say up until in your whole life, up until this point, you've been listening to only Miley Cyrus and Britney Spears. But today you decide, you know what? I want to see what Jay-Z is about. And you turn Jay-Z on. Well, immediately your streaming app is showing you Kanye West and Lauryn Hill and giving you ideas about what you might want to listen to next. So that stream processing is a really powerful and what gives the gives real-time calculations. Like if it's a rideshare app, you know exactly how far away your ride is. But it can also be used to implement business rules and business policies, and it can be used for real-time analytics. And then let's also talk about with our system the communications layer. So specifically, it's called pub-sub communication for publish-subscribe. So we could have any microservice, a containerized microservice. And just like we talked about before with it being extensible, we can very easily plug it into, we can write a new microservice and plug it into our system and immediately have it start consuming from any stream and producing to a new stream or even producing to a stream that already exists. And none of the other applications need to be concerned with it at all. So it's highly pluggable. Not only that, but because of the stream history we talked about before, when you plug it into the system, you don't have to have it start consuming from right this moment. It can be consuming from as long as from the beginning of your application if you've been saving your stream history for that long. So as long as that stream history persists, when you plug in a new system, it can consume from either the old data or it can be consumed from the present moment. So with that, we've talked about the major benefits of event-driven architecture that sit on top of the Reactive Manifesto ideas for system design with eventing at its core.